It's my great pleasure to welcome to the stage Amber Vanderburg. She is the Director of Human Resources at Paradigm Ship. Please welcome Amber.
One, two, three, four.
You my winning. It's like 25 the lives that you bust out of prison. Something's in the
hello, hello. If you are ready to hear about the power of performance feedback, let me hear you. Okay. Well, let's see here. I have some judges here to see how they think we did. Okay. We got a 7, a 5, and a 3 out of 10 on that. I think we can do a lot better. So, let me ask again. If you are ready to hear about the power of performance feedback, let me hear you! All right, I saw some hand raise. Okay, all right. Let's see here. Let's see what we got this time. Judges, okay. Too quiet, thanks. Beats too close together, all right. And lack of depth. Okay, that's a little nitpicky. All right, I think, all right, we can work with that a little bit. We need to be a little bit louder, need beats further apart. Okay, all right, I think we can do this. All right, are you ready? If you are ready to hear about the power of performance feedback, let me hear you. Hey, all right. That was a lot better. All right, judges, let's see what we got here. Judge number one. All right, 9 out of 10, okay. We're getting a lot better here. Let's see here. Judge number one says, what I think really makes an excellent performance is one that builds. Ooh, okay. I like it to begin slowly and then get louder like a crashing wave. Oh, very poetic. All right, so we need to start slowly and we need to build up to what we're doing. What you did was great for the end part, but it would have been much more impactful if you created some contrast between the beginning and the end. All right, now 9 out of 10, we can work with that. Judge number two, let's see what you said. 8 out of 10, okay. Let's see here. Judge number two said that you can also increase the crescendo, ooh, must be a musician, by starting with a slower, quieter clapping. Kind of imagining an Icelandic clap, but then getting faster and louder towards a real triumphant ending. Okay, all right, this is something we can work with. Judge number three, let's see what we got. 6 out of 10. Okay, thanks, Judge number three. All right, Judge number three says, you're looking for a sharper sound as well. I'm not hearing a lot of claps. You keep clapping with the middle part of your hands, but you really want a sharp sound. All right, so we want to clap with the middle part of our hands. Okay, we have a lot of feedback now. This is our final go. If you are ready to hear. Hold on, I know, it's so exciting. We're gonna start slow and we're gonna build up. We're gonna start quiet, we're gonna get louder. So if you are ready to hear about the power of performance feedback, let me hear you. Let's see here, judges, what do we got? 10 out of 10, okay, thank you so much. All right, 10 out of 10. Well, hello everyone, my name is Amber Vanderburg, and I am here today to talk to you about the power of performance feedback. In case if you cannot tell by my accent, I am indeed American. In fact, a few years ago, I was the only American, the only female, the only Christian, and the only blonde academy football coach, or soccer coach, for the Adidas Game Day Academies and Paris Saint-Germain PSG Academies in Bangalore, India, to coach widely the first generation of athletes on both an elite and a grassroots level. I coached about a dozen teams, mostly boys, with a few girls, ages 6 to about 16. And as I joined the team, I discovered that the way that we communicated, the feedback that we gave our team, dramatically affected the performance that we had. In fact, I noticed that oftentimes our players would come to our sessions and they would stand in a line, kick a ball, wait for instruction. And they would come to our trainings and they would stand in a line, kick a ball, wait for direction. And they would come to our trainings and they would stand in a line, kick a ball, wait for direction. And while this may have been an efficient way to teach a skill, in a game scenario, it was a disaster, as oftentimes our players, within the course of the game, would kick the ball perfectly, exactly the way that we taught them. And then before the play was even over, they would turn to the sideline to the coach for further direction and feedback. They had mastered the task, but they didn't quite understand how it applied to the overall game scenario. While this may sound like a story about a foreign academy in sports with kids, how often do we go to work, receive a task, and wait for instruction? And it's oftentimes in these scenarios that we hear words like leadership, teamwork, creativity, because we know that these are really good words. But if we're in the wrong position, then saying these words are not only ineffective, but they're actually detrimental to our overall communication within the team. So today, I'm going to share a story of how we transformed our organization from lines and laps and lectures to one of creativity and collaboration and captainship. And the first thing that you have to do is stop. Truly, stop. Put everything down for just a moment. I'm actually going to speak to, I'm going to talk to this side of the room for just a moment. Hang tight, you will not be forgotten. I'm going to speak to this side of the room. You see, I have recently arrived here to Hungary. It's my first time here. And I come bearing a new best practices manual. And so we are going to try to do our best practices manual perfectly right now. So first, I need everyone to stand up. Only this side of the room. Only this side of the room. There you are. And like every great speaker, I'm going to read directly from the board. So, first thing that you need to do is you need to put your feet perfectly in line with your shoulders. You need to point your toes to the left. You want to put your shoulders back, your elbows in a position outwards, your hands in a position as if to perform a push-up. Open palms, fingertips loose, ready for jazzy fingers. Eyebrows lifted high to expose those headlines. You're going to put your mouth in a perfect O shape. Oh, I'm seeing some people. Oh, I see you. All right. Let's see those hands out. And at the designated time being the count of three, we are going to lift up and down on our toes, repeating rapidly. We are going to bring our hands together, making a clapping noise, keeping our fingers in perfect sync, and then bringing them apart. And then at the designated time, we are going to exert a woo and woohoo sound. Are you ready? No, you're not ready. I see some people. You need to put your elbows back. There you go. Or sorry, your shoulders back. Your elbows out. Oh, I can see a better. All right, I can't see your headlines, sir. Ah, okay. Ready. One, two, three. Woo! All right, clap your hands. Clap your hands up and down on your shoulders. I need to hear the woohoos. Ah, hear more woohoos. And stop. Oh man, that was very good. All right, you all may have a seat. Thank you so much. I bet you didn't realize this was an interactive presentation. So, who can tell me, what were you doing? You have no idea. You're doing the best practices manual. How do we know if this was successful or not? I tell you. Sure, I'd give you maybe a 7 out of 10. Okay, if you had to do this again to do it better, to get a 10 out of 10, how would you do it better? I tell you, okay. Okay, Right, we can work on steps 1 through 12. We can perfect these steps and it'll be great. Now you guys can have a, you guys can sit tight for just a moment. Don't worry, I haven't forgotten about this side of the room. Now, the first side did a pretty fantastic job. They did everything that I asked, steps 1 through 12. And so what we are going to do is we are going to stand up. Stand up. And we are going to cheer as loudly and as rambunctiously as we can, as loudly and as crazily as we can, with to show our appreciation for this side of the room. Our goal is to put a smile on every single one of their faces, okay? So cheer as loudly and as rambunctiously as you can with the goal of putting a smile on every single one of their faces. Are you ready? Yes, okay. Ready, set, go. And stop. Stop. You all may have a seat. Very, very good. So, who can tell me, what were you doing? Cheering. Absolutely, cheering. And how do we know if that was successful or not? Looking at their faces, absolutely. If we had to do this again to improve, to be louder and more rambunctious, how would we do that? Ask them, yes. Make them smile more. Bring in a marching band. Be as loud and as rambunctious as we can. So, how do we set the stage for good performance feedback? We simply stop. We stop over commanding the how, and we start clearly communicating the what and the why. Here's the reality. Both sides were cheering. But I was able to make an entire side of the room of completely professional, highly educated adults look like buffoons by over-communicating the how. I over-communicated in my initial conversation when I initially, I over-commanded in my initial conversation whenever I gave you the task. Notice in my follow-up communication, in my performance feedback, I again was looking at steps 1 through 12. In our retrospective, we were again focusing on steps 1 through 12. Here, we were focused on our goal. And even though both sides were cheering, the way that we presented the challenge dramatically affected the performance. To give great performance feedback, we must first set the stage for great performance. And this doesn't take a dramatic change in our communication. It takes a slight shift. In the football pitch, in the soccer field, it looked a little something like this. Rather than stand in a line, kick a ball, wait for instruction, we provided challenges. So from here, kick the ball to knock down those three cones. Because in order to do that, you're going to have to kick with power and precision. And in a game scenario, whenever you pass, whenever you kick, whenever you shoot, you're also going to have to kick with power and precision. From this, I saw some of the most heated debates I'd ever seen amongst seven-year-olds trying to decide if the best way to kick the ball was with the infoot or with the laces. In reality, both ways were right. And so we were able to expand the toolbox of resources that our players had to complete their tasks and to achieve their goals. Now, while they were able to expand their toolbox of resources, they now had conflict that they did not have before. There was not as much conflict whenever there was only one way to kick the ball, but now there were at least two. See, with an opportunity for ownership with the how, with an opportunity for ownership comes a greater opportunity for conflict. But with an opportunity for conflict also comes a greater opportunity for conversation over complacency. Ooh, that's good, I'll say it again. With an opportunity for ownership comes a greater opportunity for conflict, which also comes a greater opportunity for conversation over complacency. They didn't accept that there was just one way to do things. They looked at a variety of different methods that they could use to achieve their goals. Now, we didn't just want to create an environment where there would be more conflict and then not prepare our players to engage in that conflict in a more healthy manner. And so, we encouraged our players to engage in proactive conversations. Proactive conversations is a tool that I use today, not only in sports, but whenever I come into a new team, whenever I begin a new project, whenever I have a new client, and a proactive conversation goes a little bit something like this. At some point in this project, I'm going to fail you. At some point in this relationship, there is going to be frustration. There is going to be conflict. There is going to be heat. It's going to happen. So while the emotions are low now, let us discuss how we want to handle that situation when it arises. This is a short conversation, but it is so powerful. You see, so many times we avoid confronting unmet expectations because we don't want to admit that there has been conflict, that there is frustration. But by having a proactive conversation, we are setting an expectation that it will happen. You're setting a normalcy that there is going to be frustration in this relationship. And so we are going to discuss how we want to handle that. It sets an expectation of a game plan of what you are going to do when those situations arise. Now also, with those proactive conversations, it also helps us to prevent against one of the greatest hurdles, one of the greatest obstacles that come with unmet expectations. And that's what they call the fundamental attribution error. Now, fundamental attribution error is really a very fancy way of saying that too often we judge other people by their outcomes, by their behaviors, while we judge ourselves by our intentions. So while you set the stage for great performance by communicating the what and the why and giving ownership with the how, and while you've had those proactive conversations, unmet expectations will still arise. And that is when we must have those conversations. And that is when so often we must be aware of the fundamental attribution error. Oftentimes it looks a little something like this. Bob may come across as very abrupt and abrasive, and sometimes even malicious in your weekly meetings. But his intention is to be confident, to be persuasive, to be passionate. But naturally, his intention is not matching the outcomes. In this, it is important to bring about that conversation by asking, hey, what was your intention when you did that? What were you trying to do? Because this isn't someone trying to be abrupt and abrasive. It is someone that is intending to be confident and persuasive. So there is a knowledge gap. And it provides a platform for you as a leader and you as a coach to have a conversation and an action plan to bring the two ideas of intention and outcomes closer together. Now, whenever you are discussing these, whenever you are having these conversations, it is important, above all else, that you then get specific to get strategic. You see, we're not judging people just by their outcomes. We are also looking at their intentions and then helping them and coaching them and guiding them so that their intentions and their outcomes can come closer together. Imagine if I, as a coach, reprimanded every single one of my players that took a shot on goal and missed. Rather, I see their intention and what they're trying to do, and I can coach them and guide them so that they can be more successful in the future. And so with these action steps, we then get very specific so that we can be strategic. Imagine I see many coaches that go up to their players at the end of the game and they say, hey, good game, good job, keep up the good work, well done. Which all sounds very nice, except the player then doesn't know what they have done well, what they should repeat, what they need to improve. It's too vague. Vague feedback will result in vague outcomes. Ambiguous feedback will result in ambiguous outcomes. And this happens for both positive and not so positive feedback that we must give. You see, the purpose of all feedback comes down, to three purposes. The first is to coach or to build upon behavior. The second is to reinforce or encourage good behavior. And the third is to correct undesired behavior. And if we are vague in any of our feedback, then it will not help us to accomplish the goal of correcting, of coaching, or encouraging. So rather than say, good game, I go to my players and I say specifically, hey, you did a really good job today of staying with that person, of keeping up the good work. You got all of the rebounds. You made really good passes. These are the things that I want you to continue to do in the future. See, in your company and in your team, if you don't know why something is working when it's working, then you probably won't know how to fix it whenever it's broken. You need to be specific on what exactly is working. And be specific not only in the task, but be specific in the method that you are using to give feedback to that person. Make it personal. Whenever I was in America, I coached girls and co-ed teams. Whenever I moved to India, I coached mostly boys teams. And their preference of feedback was a little bit different. And so I altered the method of feedback, whether that be in private, in public, one-on-one. I altered that method to best fit the needs of my players individually. On the other end, if you have undesired performance, again, get specific to get strategic. I had one player that loved coming into games at halftime whenever we were down. And with absolute consistency, he would always come in and he would know exactly what we needed to do to come back and win the game. He would walk into the locker room and he would say, guys, we just need to play better. Gee, thanks. You see, while he was correct, it was too ambiguous for any tangible feedback, any tangible action. I encourage you to go through a series of what's and why's and how's. So we need to play better, yes. What specifically can we do better? Well, we can keep possession of the ball more, right? We keep on turning the ball over to the other team. Okay, how can we keep the ball more? Well, we can make better passes. Okay. All right, this only required a couple layers more, right? How can we make better passes? Well, if we can take the time to look up and see who's open, then we can make clearer passes to one another, and then we can move the ball forward more efficiently. Okay, now, just after a few series of questions, we are able to have a more actionable idea of what we can do specifically to be better. I encourage you, whenever you are asking these questions, to be very mindful of the way that we are asking these questions. I'll give you an example. What is 5 plus 5? Oh, arithmetic. What is 5 plus 5? 12. Okay, it's okay. 5 plus 5 equals 10. What two numbers equal 10? 9 plus 1, 6 and 4, 7 and 3. Right. The way that we ask our questions dramatically affect the answers that we will get and the action steps that we can have moving forward. So be very specific so that you can get strategic on what you can do whenever you are moving forward. Now, You might be thinking, Amber, this is a lot that you're asking of me. You're asking me to take the time to have proactive conversations, to give ownership, to be specific, to be strategic. That is a lot that you are asking. But the good news is that you really shouldn't be the only person in your team that is giving this feedback. As a coach, I should not be the only voice that is heard on the field. Oftentimes, as a coach, I shouldn't even be the loudest voice on the field. There are so many other people that are involved in the game that are more involved, that are differently involved. They're in different positions. They have different relationships. They have different insights. They have different responsibilities, and they are able to give different feedback than what I can see from the sidelines. Some companies call this a 360 review. It's very common where you provide an opportunity for clients, for coworkers, for people from different departments to all come in and give more well-rounded feedback so that you can have a holistic view of how you are performing as a team player. Whether you do this in an official 360 review or you are in a more informal 360 review where you allow other people to give feedback, I encourage you to empower and equip your players or your team to give feedback and to take ownership of the feedback that they have. And this is powerful for a couple different reasons. First, it allows you as a team player to receive feedback from multiple different angles. And so you can have a more holistic view of how you are performing as a team member. The other often overlooked aspect of a 360 review or feedback ownership is the fact that it refocuses the idea of feedback into not just receiving, but giving. See, now I am focused not only on the feedback that I am receiving, but on the feedback that I am giving to the rest of my team. And what that does is it dramatically changes the focus from the individual scorecard to the overall scoreboard. And so feedback ownership is very important so that we can then have a more holistic view of what success looks like throughout our team. Now, how often should we give feedback? Now, one of my degrees is in communication, and so whenever I think of feedback loops, one of the things I think of is this. So you have a sender, that's me, you have a receiver, there's some noise going on, and so my goal is to try and get through the noise so that you can receive this message. If you're more of a fan of The Lion King, then your feedback loop might look more like the circle of life. Considering who we're talking to today, it might be more of a design feedback loop. If you're in Agile, it might look more like this. We're looking at different sprints. So why in all of this does our formal feedback look a little something like this whenever it comes to our organizations? You see, over here in the yellow line represents January. And you see, we begin work in January, and we work in January, February, March, April, and then we keep on working in March, April, May, June, July, August, September, October, November, and then December comes, and we have our annual review. And this is the opportunity that we talk about things that happened in February and December. It's important that we take the time to give feedback consistently and in a timely manner. Sometimes this isn't only our annual feedback review. This could be also in the course of a project. I speak with a lot of university professors, and they get their feedback review at the end of the semester. Why are we waiting so long whenever you could be asking for feedback and receiving feedback throughout the project, throughout the course of your time with the team? And so what if our formalized feedback look a little something like this, where we were giving more feedback consistently all the time. And then our red box at the end wasn't anything new, but it was really just a summary of all of the feedback that we had received before. Now, of course, this is not a circle. And so this represents more of the loops that we have as a formalize feedback. Now, there are some that argue that the annual review should be taken away altogether. Personally, I think that it is fine if it takes on a different form and that it is more of a summary of all of the feedback that you have accumulated over the year rather than one massive feedback at the end of the year. So it takes on a different form. This is a love letter. It was written to my great-grandmother in 1912 by a man named Otis. Now I must admit to you, my great-grandfather was not named Otis. So apparently my great-grandmother was quite the heartthrob. And the love letter reads this: fall off the roof, fall down the cellar, but don't fall in love with another feller. What makes love letters so romantic? There's a lot of different things. It could be the intention with which you write the letters. It could be the time that it takes to be so bold to write down these words of passion. But so often, love letters are so romantic, even here on Valentine's Day, they are so romantic because there is a span of time between each of the letters being received. And so there is time for those words to sink in and for you to ponder on the words that have been written. Every single letter that my great-grandmother received, there was at least a few weeks of time for her to think about the words and to think about if she wanted to get with Mr. Otis. In the same regard, the way that we communicate our feedback, the method of communication that we use, is powerful in the way that it will be received. See, there's different types of communication that we can use depending on the nature of the feedback that we must give. If we have more of an informational type performance feedback that we can give, then it is at this point that generally a memo, an email, a text is typically used. As we move forward into a little bit more emotional, this could be the beginning of a new project, something of that sort. You might use an email or a text, but more than likely you'll have a meeting. You'll have a phone call. You'll have a little bit more be a little bit more personable. This is in the middle, so it can go on either side of the spectrum. Generally, whenever it comes to texts, emails, Slacks, I encourage teams to come up with a standard of how many emails it will take to solve the problem before we agree that it's important to pick up the phone. For example, I've worked with some teams that we have agreed that if it takes more than 6 emails for us to solve a problem, going back and forth, then we'll just pick up the phone, rather than spending weeks trying to solve these one issues. Some teams it's a little bit more, some teams it's a couple less. So I encourage teams to have that very frank conversation. That way you don't have some people that are sending these emails that are very complex that will take a long time to solve. And with each one of those emails, there is a span of time for emotion to build, for words to sink in, and for, especially if you're talking about feedback, for emotions to rise. And then lastly would be more of an emotional performance feedback that you have to give. In these scenarios, I would not suggest at all using text, email, memos. The more emotional that the performance feedback is that you must give, then try to make it as personable as you possibly can. Understanding that this is difficult whenever we have remote workplaces, try very hard to make a in-person meeting. If you cannot do that, look at Zoom, look at Skype, If you have to, you can do a phone call, but really try to be as personable as you can, depending on the nature of the feedback. Sometimes the feedback that we have is perfectly fine. The message is okay, but the method of communication that we use is too often forgotten. So be mindful of the emotional scale of the feedback that you are about to give or receive. Be mindful of the method of communication that you use in those moments. Now, this is called the stretch conference. Of course we need to stretch a little. So, what I'm going to do is I want everyone to put their hand high in the air and give me a big okay. I am from Oklahoma, and so we say Oklahoma is okay. All right, we're gonna lift high in the air. We're gonna reach down below. We're gonna go to the right. Go to the left. We're going to make a big circle. Big circle again. On the count of three, we're gonna put it on our cheek. One, two, three. Oh, there are three types of people in the room here. There are some that are looking around saying, what's going on? There are some that heard me say, put it on your cheek. Ah, and then there's a couple that are like this and they go, ah, dang. Hmm? I've been there the whole time. Yeah, sure you were. Whenever it comes to performance feedback, our actions speak so much louder than our words. You can say as much as you want when it comes to performance feedback, but it is the most important that our actions back up the performance that we give with our words. We must have the relationship with our team. We must show through our actions the words that we are speaking. And above all else, you can use all of the tools that we have gone over today, but if you do not take the time to be active in supporting your team's success, then your team will know. Teams will know if your words are disingenuous. As they say, people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. We don't just want to use the good words. We want to act them out. It reminds me of a young man, a young lad that I used to coach. He was about 6 years old. And his name was Achinthia. Achinthia was so excited for his first day of football. He came running out onto the field and he began yelling, pass, pass, pass! And I noticed that Achinthia was yelling pass even whenever the other team had the ball. And he was yelling pass whenever he was miles away from the action. And he was yelling pass even whenever he had the ball. And so then he was running with the ball, going pass, pass, pass. And so I looked at Achinthia and I said, Achinthia, why are you yelling pass? And he looked up at me and he said, Miss Emberman, I do not know what it means. I only know it as a football word. Sometimes I hear teams and I hear leaders sound a little bit like my friend Achinthia, yelling, leadership, teamwork, collaboration, innovation, performance, feedback, we got this! Because we know these are really good words that can lead to really big goals. But if we're in the wrong position, if we're miles away from where we should be, or even if we have the ball and we don't know in which direction we're going, then saying these words are not only ineffective, they're actually detrimental to our communication. Eventually, the team is going to tune you out. But if we take the time to build relationships, to foster a culture of ownership, if we have a culture where there is some conflict, but we have proactive conversations, if we have a culture where we are specific so we can get strategic, if we have a culture that we have action steps so that we can improve, if we have a culture where we are mindful so that we are personable and that we are specific and that we are mindful of the way that we are communicating, then and only then we will be in a position to yell pass, to receive the ball, to move forward, and to score really big goals. Last stretch of the day. I want everyone to raise their hand as high as they can. Okay, now I want you to raise it just a little bit higher. Wow, you can put your hands down. Notice, I told you to raise your hand as high as you could, but whenever I told you to raise it a little bit higher, everyone in this room was able to go just a little bit higher. What's the power of performance feedback? It's the ability to take someone's highest and to go just a little bit higher. Thank you so much for having me today.
I just let the crowd cheer for you. Uh-huh. You made it obvious that this crowd loves clapping way more than breathing.
You were great clappers.
Yeah, I think we have great questions, so let's jump right into them. How would you give feedback to a leader who is incredibly happy with his team and cannot find a single thing to correct, / never gives negative feedback?
Oh man, that's so, yes. So in those scenarios, what I do is I first create a full value contract in saying, hey, everything might be great now, but don't we want to create an environment where we want to continuously improve? Mm-hmm. Exactly. And so then it changes the paradigm just slightly. And so you're not so much admitting that there are a lot of problems. You're saying, oh, everything's good, but we're making this even better. Mm-hmm. And so these are things that we can improve upon. Mm-hmm. Most leaders are okay with the fact that they want to continuously improve. Mm-hmm. Maybe not want to admit that there's a whole lot of problems. And so by changing the verbiage just slightly, oftentimes you can create better buy-in so that they are more open to those conversations and change.
Oh, thank you. That's wonderful. How do you get through someone's completely wrong self-assessment?
Can you please repeat that?
How do you get through someone's completely wrong self-assessment?
So generally whenever those happen, I have a follow-up conversation with that person. Mm-hmm. So self-assessments are generally done in private, just by themselves.
Yeah.
And so then I take the time to have a conversation. Mm-hmm. At that point, I don't bring in the other feedback that I'm getting from other people. Mm-hmm. Generally, I know that the assessment is widely incorrect because of not only what I see, but from the rest of the team. And so I don't bring in their feedback just yet. I just have follow-up conversations and questions with that person. And whenever it's in person, a lot of times you can ask the questions that are needed to get to the root cause on why they believe that they are performing well or that they're doing well. And you can also get to the root cause of how you can best help them and improve.
My phone just died, so I'm going to do this. What method of communication do you choose for giving feedback if the receiver struggles with, for example, sensitivity to criticism, depression, or low self-confidence?
Oh, as personal as possible. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So text, email, I would not recommend that. Okay. If there is going to be high emotion, I would be as personable as possible. Mm-hmm. So an in-person meeting is the most preferred. Mm-hmm. But if you have to do a Skype, a Zoom, something of that sort, then that is possible as well. But being very sensitive to that to those emotions, and then using the method of communication of as personable as possible. Yeah.
But also, I think on a level of content, do you need to use a different language in that situation, or like what would you suggest content-wise?
Absolutely. Yes, do you use different language? I alter the method of communication and the language that I use depending on the person. Mm-hmm. So depending on what the person is self-conscious about specifically, then I will alter that communication. It really does depend on the person. Mm-hmm. So as a leader, that's a huge part of your job, is not giving blanket communication, but taking that time to know those insecurities and know those pain points, and then altering the communication there. So if you have that question, I would love to discuss that a little bit more specifically, depending on the self-consciousness.
And how would you introduce feedback culture in a company where the instruments like 360s, 101s are there, but individuals don't care about them?
360s are great if done well. If they are not done well, then they can be detrimental, which is one reason why I very much include feedback ownership as a whole, not so much the actual system, but the ideas behind it. So I really want to add in that caveat with that. If you do have people that do not take the 360 feedback seriously, what I do is, first off, I do have a conversation. Generally, that is a domino effect. Many people will feel that way, and so we create a full value contract. Sometimes there is a different preferred form of communication, and so we'll really just have a conversation. Hey, do you want to do these? Mm-hmm. Is there a different form of communication that you prefer? Mm-hmm. And what is that? And can we agree on that? Mm-hmm. And so creating that full value contract is extremely valuable. Mm.
And do you think feedback should be evaluating or rather describing your feelings, observations, and how the action of the other person impacted you?
Oh, yes. Always address the actual behavior. always address the actual behavior. It can be very easy to allow your emotions to reach the level of the person receiving the feedback. So really address the actual behavior and the actions so that you can have an action step. Mm-hmm. There isn't much of an action step that you can have to, you're annoying me, right? that's not going to be very productive. But there can be an action step with, this is the behavior that might be annoying me, right? But this is the behavior that we are addressing specifically. Mm-hmm. So yeah, rather than emotions, address the actual behavior. Emotions aren't going to be as productive.
I agree with you 100%. Mm-hmm. I mean, I never received a feedback like, you annoy me, but that would have hurt my feelings as well. Do you think it is possible to have only peer feedback sessions and remove the performance feedback sessions with the leaders?
I personally have never done that. Mm-hmm. And so I would be very interested to see in what that would be like. It could work. I think if you had the right team and the right agreed upon goals, so that would very much require a proactive conversation and a very in-depth agreed upon metrics. Mm-hmm. And what would be considered success.
Yeah, also interesting why you would consider leaving your leader out in this situation.
Yeah.
What if you want to introduce, for example, monthly feedback system to your team, but they just hate it?
I would first ask why you would want a monthly feedback system. If you are doing bi-monthly, or if you're doing, you know, what is not working about the current system that you have and what a monthly system would solve. So I think if you rephrase that question to, okay, this is why we are changing from, you know, yearly to monthly or 6 months to monthly, I think first having that conversation and phrasing it as something that would be helpful rather than a chore or a responsibility, that will help increase buy-in, but then it will also help increase your idea of success if monthly is working or not.
Amber, thank you so much for everything, really. Here's this little something from us to you.
Thank you.
And we love that. This is your first time in Budapest and you already have a best practices list.
Yes.
We appreciate it a lot. Thank you so much, Amber.
Thank you so much.